Welcome everyone to a Kepler webinar. Today we have David Cochrane. He is going to be sharing his research into Chiron. And the question is, what does it mean? Wounded healer, quiet charisma, or focused self-expression? Speaking of David, who is he? He is the founder of Cosmic Pattern Software. He's also the author of the Kepler and Sirius Astrological Programs. And he has been involved in the astrological community for over three decades. It's actually pretty impressive. He's got amazing programming skills. He's also an excellent teacher and an excellent speaker. So the software that he's created, he also uses, especially the research capabilities where he can go and pick out and analyze charts to start looking at the way we use our astrology and how well it seems to match up in practice. And that is where this webinar came from. He did a lot of research in looking at Chiron. So one of the things he did was look at charts to see how Chiron in important configurations in the chart, how it was playing out. So I'm going to pass over to you, David. Thank you so much for being here and agreeing to do our webinar today. Delighted to have you.
Okay. Thank you, Enid, and thank you, everyone, for attending. Okay, let's jump into this. Chiron, wounded healer, quiet charisma. I've changed the title. I've added one more thing. The original title was wounded healer, quiet charisma, or focused self-expression. Well, I'm giving you another choice. Or an electric circuit. So this will become clear what I mean by this in a second. Okay, well, let me tell you straight away what I think Chiron, the astrological meaning of Chiron is, and then I'll explain how I came up with this idea, at least some of the ways I came up with it. Okay, here's my definition. You all ready? This is it. I'm suggesting that the heart, the essence of what Chiron is, I've got it in a few words here, the electricity of Uranus travels through Saturn's circuit. You could call it circuit or structure, and it probably, as all you know, is a very low resolution image, but I think you get the idea. This orangish pinkish color, this is the orbit of Jupiter, and then of course there's Saturn, and this green one is the orbit of Uranus, and the white one is Chiron. So as you know, Chiron, I think as probably all of you know, Chiron's orbit extends from Uranus to Saturn. Now, I did not come up with the interpretation for Chiron based on the astronomy, but after I started sorting out what it means, I realized that it was related to the orbit, or at least appears to be. So Chiron integrates the qualities of Uranus and Saturn specifically by bringing the electricity, the spontaneity, the liveliness, the being in the moment quality of Uranus, but instead of Uranus, which just likes to go however it wants to go, any way it wants to go, Chiron seeks to channel that vibrant, alive energy into a very clear pattern, a very clear structure. That's what I'm proposing. Okay, what about Chiron is supposed to be the wounded healer? That's what we've always been told. A lot of very good astrologers like Melanie Reinhardt and Philip Sedgwick and lots of people who specialize in asteroids have emphasized that. So what am I doing here, upsetting the apple cart and coming up with a new interpretation? Well, let's take this, the two parts of this, wounded healer. Let's take the wounds part of it first. Actually, I do agree that wounds are common with Chiron. They're not necessary. So I think the wounded healer concept is a symptom, an expression of the underlying energy, okay? So I've got a little story here to illustrate what I'm saying. Imagine, this is just for illustration purposes, don't take this too literally, but just conceptually. Let's say you have a child and you tell the child, you have homework to do, you know, it's getting late, do your homework, I know you've got a lot of homework that's due tomorrow. Now what would the child who has Sun conjunct Uranus do? Suppose Sun is conjunct Uranus in the natal chart, extremely tight, less than, say, a 10-minute orb. Well, we might imagine the child does things, and when the child grows up to be an adult, it continues, does things her own way, possibly doesn't do the homework at all, is this too boring, you know, wants to improvise. Now, this is a problem that parents and teachers are familiar with. They're frustrated, but they deal with this all the time. They know this problem. Now, let's take the child with Sun conjunct Saturn. I'm using Saturn and Uranus because Chiron has qualities of both of these planets. We can imagine that the child with Sun conjunct Saturn is going to be responsible and focuses and does her homework. I'm going to focus on Saturn as focus, as narrowing things down, getting down to the bone, we associate Saturn with bones or essence, stripping away the fat and making clear what the underlying pattern is. You can also look at Saturn as frustration and so on, but I'm in this context, I'm focusing on Saturn in that way. Now, what does the child with Sun conjunct Chiron do? Just to illustrate the idea. What we would imagine is because there's this drive to Saturn, the child wants to do her homework. It's important to her, just like it is to the Sun conjunct Saturn. But she wants to breathe her own life into it. She wants to put her own inspiration into it. She wants to feel like she's channeling, that she's inspired by that work. So we're used to thinking of Saturn and Uranus as contradictory. What happens with Chiron is the person feels liberated, feels inspired when they're able to express some, you might say, archetypal pattern. So, you know, through the pattern, they feel liberated. Now, what happens when you get very creative and you breathe your own life into it as a child? Sometimes your answers are marked as wrong because you're not giving the answer that was desired, especially with standardized tests and if you have a fairly conservative upbringing. This often hurts the feelings of the person with Sun conjunct Chiron or a strong Chiron in general. They want to get it right. They're not getting it right. They begin to doubt their inspiration. And this Chiron process is rather subtle. The person feels this need to express themselves in that structure. It can get overlooked, and the response of people is often that you're just being sloppy. So you often experience wounds if you're a strong Chiron person. Now, I hope you can all follow that, right? It's a very simple idea. You just have to visualize how I'm imagining what Chiron is. Now, what about the healing aspect of Chiron? I'm suggesting that the wounded healer is a symptom of an underlying process. Well, let's imagine this child getting older, this child with the strong Sun conjunct Chiron. Chiron tends to be modest, unlike Uranus, which is rebellious and just expresses itself however it wants, and you have to deal with it. Chiron tends to be modest. It takes responsibilities, exercises, and discipline seriously. The modesty is usually appreciated. The talent often gets ignored. But the person with a strong Chiron tends to keep trying to get better and better. And here's a phrase for you, find your voice. The Chiron person tries to find their voice. So if they're, let's take music literally, if their interest is music, they learn the scales, they learn this, but they're always trying to breathe their own life into it and find their own voice. It's extremely important to the Chiron person. After some time, if the person succeeds in channeling their Chiron energy, they do develop their own voice, people love it, and they can receive a lot of recognition for it. The voice becomes healing because there's energy flowing. What Chiron does is it unblocks the energy to flow through the circuit. You can imagine it like a flipping on a light switch. All of a sudden the current is running, the lights go on. Chiron inclines to be performers, singers, performers, athletes also. What do you do when you're an athlete? You learn the pattern, how to swim, how to hit the golf ball. There's a pattern, there's a design that's the right way to do it, and if you can become alive with it, you basically channel that force through that pattern. So singers, performers, athletes, thinkers who move people or speakers, massage therapists, Reiki healers, very common with Chiron. So the kind of healing it is energy healing. And it's not always healing as we call it. It can be the powerful voice or performance. It tends not to be flamboyant, but has a strong effect on others. Okay, you got it? You have the image of what I'm saying about Chiron and how the things that we often say about Chiron are typical symptoms of this process. Okay, I hope that's clear. Now, next thing I want to point out. So I talked about Chiron, the wounded healer, and what I'm suggesting is that wounded healer is a expression of the underlying process of the electrical energy of Uranus flowing through a clear pattern, a clear structure, a clear, well-defined circuitry. Quiet charisma. You might not have heard of Chiron associated with quiet charisma. I happen to see article online by astrologer Elsa Panazon, and she said that Chiron is the planet of quiet charisma, and she gives charts of several singers and other people who have this kind of elegance, dignity, quiet demeanor, but powerful effect on people. I thought that was amazing because quiet charisma is extremely common with strong Chiron, because what does it mean to have this lively, powerful energy flowing through a clear circuit where the motivation of the person is to be good at it? The emphasis is not so much, oh, gee, I want to improvise and go wild. They want to do it right. It's almost like a Virgo emphasis. They want to have it precise and clear and breathe life into that circuitry. So you often end up with this quiet charisma. Chiron tends to be modest and humble, but very magnetic and very powerful. That's the idea. You got it? Phase one of my lecture, what I think Chiron is. Now, you may like my idea. You may not like my idea. But I've laid it out right up front, so you have it. So let me summarize some points very quickly. Chiron is lively and vibrant self-expression through a pattern. There's structure and focus. Typical symptoms or behaviors you get, the ability to perform well in music, theater, dance, or sports. Those are focused on lively self-expression. Those are things not often emphasized with Chiron, but I think they're very common. Finding freedom in the structure and the pattern, patterns that give life and movement, freedom through attunement. And sometimes quiet charisma, sometimes the unblocking or channeling energy to move through the system. A therapeutic and healing effect is possible, such as with energy healing or massage. So that's just to summarize what I'm saying. Okay. Great idea, nice image, incorporate Saturn-Uranus, very cool. But is it true? A lot of ideas can sound cool, but how do I know this? How do we come up with this stuff? Well, I think what we do in astrology typically is we take in an idea and we see if it resonates. Does it resonate in our soul? Does it seem to be some like archetypal truth? And then we look at some charts of friends, family, famous people. We see if it works. I think that's generally what we do in astrology. I personally believe that that's very important. I think it's a wonderful thing to do, and I actually take it to extremes. What I'll do, for example, is when I'm researching famous people, I will try to find interviews of them. I will listen to them. I will close my eyes. I will imagine that I'm that person. I try to divorce myself from my own egoic nature, my own consciousness centered around myself, and try to move, I call it moving into the person. I take this really to extremes. So I really believe that feeling, sensing, experiencing what another person's experience is and relating that to the chart is very valid and very important. However, it's not all that I do. The other thing that I do is I do research. I go crunch numbers. So this strikes some people as a little bit odd. Is David an intuitive or is he a scientist? What's going on here? Well, you know, I never cared much for labels anyway. I figure all these things are gifts. They're all available, and you just do what you have an inclination to do. So I do it all. Why not? So here's the first really radical idea I'm going to present you with. I got two hugely radical ideas. Maybe you think my interpretation of Chiron is radical, maybe not. But this is definitely radical, that I'm suggesting that in astrology, we need to test our ideas more beyond our experience of individual people. And one of the ways that I do research, and I think it's extremely powerful in research methodology, if you want to impress your friends, it's called extreme case sampling on the independent variable. Did that sound impressive? Did that intimidate you? That's what the research method is called. In plain English, what that means is you take people who have whatever astrological thing you're interested in, who have that very extreme in their charts. So what I do, what I did with the Chiron, for example, is I run through the database of famous people. I use only people with AA accuracy from a birth certificate in this particular study. Sometimes I go down to A accuracy, depending on what I'm doing. And I make a criterion for who is strong Chiron. And what I did in this case is I gave 50 points for Sun conjunct Chiron and 40 points for Moon conjunct Chiron. And then whoever has the most points, we have to try to make sense out of their Chiron. It's a little game. It's a little game we play that we see if it works. Now, you may say that's not the only thing that makes for strong Chiron. Blah, blah, blah. I know all that. But the idea is that by simplifying the problem, and I put in big yellow, you must use all the charts. That's the big difference. You don't get to cherry pick whose chart you're going to look at or not look at. You must use all the charts. And the point is not that there are other people with strong Chiron that don't fit these criteria. But if you have Chiron conjunct the Sun with a 5-minute or 10-minute orb, Chiron should be strong. So step one in this extreme case sampling is to go through the database, give some points, pick, and then just analyze all of the people who score the most. And you can step two, you can explore the charts to see if you can make sense of them. So you can do all the things you like to do, being intuitive and whatever you want, but you're restricted to have to make sense out of these charts. This is an accepted method in research methodology. So Enid, do we have any pressing questions at this point?
A couple of these go back to some of your initial ideas about Chiron connecting to both Uranus and Saturn. Have you looked at, like, if Chiron is conjunct or makes a major aspect to Uranus and Saturn? Is that like a double whammy?
Let me answer that question right away. We're going to get to that.
Okay.
If I talk very fast because I have enough material for about 5 days. And, some people say that my purpose in life is to fry brains. I cover an enormous amount of material in a relatively short time because I have just so much stuff I want to talk about. But I will be talking about that. If Chiron is connected to Saturn and Uranus, it helps integrate them, and it's a very powerful effect. It makes you very effective in making change. You can become an agent of change, a reformer, an innovator. Okay.
So the orbs you've been talking about within minutes.
We'll get to
orbs as well. Okay.
Yeah.
And then I guess you, from what you've already said, we'll talk a little bit more about aspects and.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I don't mean to be abrupt and everything, but
no, I just. As long as we're going to cover, go for it.
Yeah, I'm a little hyperactive, so you have to put up with me. Okay, now, on the research, let me just show you very quickly what this means. So I'm in the Sirius software, so basically what happens is you go into the research feature. I'm going to just give you the idea, not that you write notes, but just to give you an idea. Whatever software you have, it should have some kind of research feature, and then you can create a new search or customize an existing one. Here's my Chiron. Let's see what I got here. I'll customize it, and then it tells me Sun and Aries. Well, I don't want that. I want an aspect Sun to Chiron. Where are you, Chiron? You must be down here somewhere. There you are. And you can actually do any asteroid. So if you're interested in, you know, Eris or whatever, you can change the names of these things. And then say you want a 0-degree aspect for conjunction. And I used a 1-degree orb applying and separating. And then I insert another item, which would be for the moon. Oh, for sun, I gave it 50 points. And for moon, I gave it 40 points. It lists them all over here. I'm just giving you a rough idea. Whatever software you use, you would set up what it is you want. And then you just run it through. I'll just click OK. And then you click on Begin the Analysis. It runs through. I can restrict it to just the AA data and so on. Anyway, and then it will produce a list. And the smaller the orb, the more points you get. So you won't get all 50 points if the orb is exact. So it lists them by who's the strongest. Now, after you do that, here's what you get. Here are the results. Doris Day has Sun conjunct Chiron 1 minute. Arissa Hill, 8 minutes. Shirley Babishoff, Waylon Jennings, Tyrone Hill, Jeff Bridges, and George Brock. I separated Michelle Kwan. She happened to be the only one with Moon with 8 minutes. These are all conjunctions. And Christian Dior, I later found that there's some, he's actually not AA, but 121 versus 130 is not much difference, and the orb was a little bit bigger. So we could include him if we want. But these are the top people. The top people. Now, here's the name of the game. The name of the game, using modern research methodology, why do I use modern research methodology? Because I think it works. I'm not trying to impress anybody. I'm not trying to prove anything. I want to know if astrology works, and I think, and how it works, and I think that these methods help me figure it out. So by forcing myself to have to analyze these charts, I start getting new insights. And I'll show you some of the insights that you get. It's fascinating. So the name of the game is, can I see how each of these people is a huge Chiron person? You got it? By forcing myself not to allow myself to pick anybody or to skip people, I could say, oh, well, Doris Day really works. I don't understand this one. By forcing myself to try to make sense out of it, I develop a much more solid form of astrology that really works. Now, here's the rules that the research methodologists, the psychologists and sociologists and other academics who use these methods, they would say, according to this theory of research methodology, that if you're able to find a consistent Chiron meaning, for example, if I think Chiron means wounded healer, how are these people wounded healers? And you can use your intuition, whatever. So there, it's not hard science. It's called exploratory research. By controlling your ability, by preventing yourself from using any old chart you want to pick, you're forced to do these. But you can use your intuition and ideas, and you have to. It's up to you to have integrity about it, that you're not stretching it. Can you make a clear case that wounded healer or quiet charisma or whatever you think is going on fits it? And what the scientists would say is, if you can fit it, you might have an accurate interpretation. If you can't match all these people to your interpretation, your idea is almost certainly wrong. Not definitely wrong, but probably wrong. That's the skeptical approach to it. Anyway, I find this stuff really works. And what I want to show you next is how these people fit the definition of Chiron, and also how it starts to reveal new things and very amazing, unusual things that I didn't expect to find. And this is why I love this kind of research, because new things start appearing that I had no idea about. Okay, everybody with me? Any pressing questions, Enid?
There's one before you go further that was, how much do you think Chiron represents the pure expression of surrogacy? Is that an idea that you utilized at all?
No, I don't know. That person could email me. I'd be very interested to learn more about it. My interpretation of Chiron right now, I've already given it to you. The amazing thing about a lot of what I do is it's extraordinarily simple. That's all there is to Chiron. It's just this electrical spontaneous energy going through a circuit, which can make you a Reiki healer. It can do a number of different things. But that's it. There's really not much more to say about it. What I want to show you is how you see it operate in people's lives and what we learn from looking at these charts.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, all right. Now, wounded healer. Does the wounded healer work? Well, for Dara's Day, one thing about this kind of research is very time-consuming. You know, I search all over the internet, start off with Wikipedia, go to YouTube, see if I can see these people, articles, etc. And I found out for Dara's Day it works. You know, she's the singer and actress, and she has this, the quiet charisma. I think it's very clear. She's like the girl next door. She's not flamboyant. She's, you know, she's not racy or wildly sexy or something. She's just, you know, kind of humble. And she, what's not obvious from looking at her in the movies and so on, is that she had a very difficult life, extremely difficult, with a lot of challenges, and she had to bounce back. So it makes sense. Waylon Jennings, he had some traumatic sorts of experiences, you could argue. Shirley Babishoff, who's a swimmer, Olympic champion swimmer, if you read about her, you would see that. Now, if we interpret healer broadly, none of these people are massage therapists or Reiki healers or psychic healers or anything else, but in the broad sense, I think you could see that it's true. The others, I'm not sure. You can draw your own conclusions. I'm just coming up with conclusions that I think are fairly reasonable. Quiet charisma, Doris Day, definitely. What about Michelle Kwan? If you remember Michelle Kwan, she's the skater. She was such a superstar. When you think of Michelle Kwan, she's humble. She's sweet. She's quiet. And people fell in love with her. Just something magnetic, the quiet charisma, because she channels that Chiron energy through the skating process. So those are two good examples of what I mean by quiet charisma. What about the focused liveliness? I mentioned actors, singers. Out of these people, seven are performers. Three are musicians, four are actors, singers, models. They're mostly performers who have this charismatic ability to perform, as opposed to somebody who's a violinist in an orchestra and is not the lead violinist or something. There's nothing about their vibrancy, their spontaneity. There's nothing Uranian, clearly Uranian about that. These are people who have that kind of impact. So overall, it fits pretty well. Now, Waylon Jennings has some charisma. I don't think he's as quiet and humble like a Michelle Kwan. And George Braque. George Braque was a colleague of Picasso. And Braque and Picasso created cubism. They're credited with it. And he doesn't appear to, he's not a performer. He just sits in front of his canvas painting. So he doesn't have that exhibiting quiet charisma in the public. He was, however, fairly quiet in terms of not bragging or being eccentric or, you know, crazy as some artists are. And one of the things that's interesting is he talked about how cubism, splitting up space, enabled one to see movement in things. So it's very abstract stuff, but he's got this idea that in order to see the life and movement, he would break up the visual field, and you could see the movement that's inherent in the objects. This is what he said, and I have a quote of it later. So the idea of movement through a pattern does seem to fit the people in general without stretching too much. So what I conclude is that the overall findings work pretty well for this interpretation of Chiron. If you take wounded healer very literally, I don't think it fits as consistently. But overall, I think this fits reasonably well with the emphasis on performers and artists, athletes and so on, and their personalities and so on. It fits reasonably well. But the next level of the research would be, what if we look at each chart? Would we see the details? Do the artists, for example, have Sun conjunct Chiron in the fifth house? Do the athletes have Sun Chiron Mars? Does it come alive for each individual? This would be the next level of the research. And what I found out is that it does, but here's radical idea number two, is I did not use normal astrological ideas. I did not use houses, signs, and rulerships. And on the next slide, I'm going to tell you what I found that's amazingly consistent in the people using a different astrological language. My third point here in this slide, suggestion, don't leave the class after I tell you what it is I looked for and what I found. Give me 15 minutes, because when I tell you what it is I looked for, a lot of people just groan and go, oh my God, I didn't sign up for this. I signed up to learn about Chiron. But give me 15 minutes. It reminds me, this situation reminds me of, I went to a party once, and there, I was with about six or seven people in a circle, and people were talking about what their occupation was, and they asked me what I do. I said, I'm a computer programmer, and somebody said, what do you program? Uh-oh, now I got to tell them what I program. These are people I didn't know. So I said, I program astrology. It didn't take more than 2 minutes for everybody to leave me. One guy said, oh, I got to get a drink. Left. The other people just walked away. So astrology sometimes, you know, is a controversial word. Sometimes people get excited about it. Sometimes they run for the hills. So I'm going to tell you what it is I looked for, and I hope you don't run for the hills and give me 10 or 15 minutes to share with you some exciting things that I think you'll get excited about. This is what I looked for. Minor aspects. And what I'm suggesting is that minor aspects are not minor. And the idea is that a trine is one-third of a circle, a square is one-fourth. So we look at it as like a wave, one-fourth of a circle, a sextile is one-sixth. What about using one-seventh, the septile? Well, we all know that septiles, maybe they exist, but they're minor. We all know this except for me and a few other people. I don't know that because I think the one-seventh is really important. I don't think it's so minor. And this is the thing that might make you start running for the hills. But give me 10 minutes, because I'm going to show you a couple of things pretty soon that I think are pretty exciting. And if nothing else, even if you don't want to hear about minor aspects being important, at least it will expand your awareness of some of the things that are going on in the field. So the idea of these minor aspects is yellow more important than blue? No, they're just different. Is 1/6 more important than 1/7? No. So the idea is all these different fractions of a circle, instead of just using 1/2, 1/4, 1/3, 1/6, 1/12, we use all kinds of fractions, and by doing that, we can see who the person is. I know that this is difficult to believe and contradicts what most of us are certain of, and I know that there are many objections to this idea. But give me 10 or 15 minutes, and I'll show you some of the findings which I think are exciting. Now, most of you recognize this as harmonic astrology. I prefer the term vibrational astrology because it more clearly describes the concept behind it. And also John Addy, who developed harmonic astrology, has some very different assumptions about how astrology works. So I call my system vibrational astrology. So the idea of vibrational astrology is more important than the zodiac signs, houses, and major aspects are the vibrational patterns, these patterns made by the minor aspects. And vibrational patterns are seen in several ways, and one is the harmonic chart. Well, I'll continue to call it harmonic chart because that's what it's known. I might want to call it vibrational chart, but it's called a harmonic chart. And here's the deal with harmonic chart. You interpret it, you don't interpret the signs and houses, but you interpret the aspects just like you would normally. You interpret them, Ptolemaic aspects, conjunction, opposition, square, trine, sextile is enough, and the idea is that each chart is a different vibration. So the basic vocabulary is you have the meanings of the planets, and whether a planet is 1/7, 2/7, or 3/7 is not that important. They're sevenths of a circle, and here are the meanings of the numbers that I used in this research. So the quintiles, 1/5 of a circle and 2/5, are creative and playful. Septiles are disciplined, focused, and introverted. Noviles, the 1/9, 2/9, 4/9, they're community-oriented, holistic, and cooperative. The 11ths of a circle are restless, moving, dynamic, and progressive. 35 equals 5 times 7, and it is a combination of 5 and 7. It's disciplined creativity, often leads to the fine arts. So, for example, when I think of Michelle Kwan, and I think, what makes a great skater? What numbers come to mind using these ideas? Well, 11, it's moving and dynamic, and 35 because it's a fine art. It's a mature art. It's more like a classical art form. It's an elegant art form. 77 combines 11, restlessness, with discipline, and 77 shows up a lot in power sports, the speed and control. Some of the best baseball players of all time have huge 7 and 77th harmonic patterns. Muhammad Ali, the boxer, has huge 77 harmonic patterns. So one of the fellows is a basketball player. I'm expecting his son, Chiron, probably lines up with other planets in the 77th harmonic. And 33 and 99, you get the smoothness of the trine, 11 times 3, and the quickness and restlessness of 11, and it makes the person progressive, and you get smooth and harmonious, fast movement. And 99, which incorporates 9, which is holistic and cooperative, inclines towards being healthy, holistic, and community-oriented, as well as fast. Now, what I'm saying is this, let me summarize, is that there's another one, there's all these astrological languages, Vedic astrology, Hellenistic astrology, various forms of modern psychological astrology. One of the languages I like to use, it's not necessarily the only language that works, there may be many languages that work, is the vibrational astrology language, and the idea is that when planets line up in these fractions of a circle, you are very strongly that way. So, for example, a lot of athletes who practice, and are very disciplined and very introverted, will have these septiles, and so on. And what we will see is that the harmonics we expect to show up, in every case except one, show up very, very powerfully, and furthermore, something incredible happens, where I see two charts that are the same, very similar patterns, and I didn't know these two people had very much in common, and they do. It's mind-boggling. All right. Did you all follow that? Let me repeat. The idea is that these minor aspects are not minor, and we're going to see the same patterns in people with the same talents with the harmonics we expect. This will become more exciting in a minute when I start showing you the charts. Okay. So, to back up a little bit, what I'm saying is that we have these people, where are they? There they are, Doris Day, Arissa Hill, and so on. Arissa Hill is extremely creative. She makes a lot of things. I'm expecting her son, Chiron, to show up with quintiles, five-based harmonics, and it does, and we see how it gets magnified. We will see that Waylon Jennings and Jeff Bridges are extremely similar. These are the two people that I thought were completely different. I know who Waylon Jennings is. He's like a country western or rock country sort of musician. I know who Jeff Bridges is. She's an actor. I had no idea how similar these two people are, but the chart said they were similar. And I looked to see if they were similar, and it was shocking. They are shockingly similar because the patterns define the energy flow available to the person. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off with Doris Day, Waylon Jennings, and Jeff Bridges, who have extremely similar patterns in their chart based on 11 with Chiron, and show how the Chiron is working through these 11-based aspects. Okay. What happens is that the 11th harmonic, which is going to show the 11th harmonic chart, which shows us the 11 vibration, the speed, the restlessness, it shows up in the charts of musicians. In this previous slide, I did research on the Gaukelin data, and I found that the 11th harmonic aspects show up more with musicians than any of the other professions, more than scientists, more than painters. That's a fact. Is that a coincidence? I don't think so. So these is an example of the kinds of research. Why do musicians incline to 11th harmonic? Because music is a dynamic art form. It's constantly moving. You have to keep on the flow to the next note, to the next action, rather than sitting there very quiet, going over the same thing over and over. It's a dynamic art form, appeals to the 11th harmonic. As very often happens, the two musicians and also an actor got in here. That kind of disturbed me. I wasn't sure what an actor was doing with the 11th harmonic, but it makes sense for Doris Day and Waylon Jennings that they all have a Mars-Jupiter-Uranus pattern in the 11th harmonic. They also have Sun, Chiron, Mars, Pluto patterns. Let me show it to you. Let me show you the 11th harmonic chart of Doris Day. Here's Doris Day. The Sun and Chiron are still conjunct, and it's with Uranus. When Chiron connects with Saturn or Uranus, it's a natural, because Chiron integrates Saturn and Uranus. We allow, now in harmonic charts, the orbs are, we allow 16 degrees for conjunction, 8 degrees for opposition, 4 degrees for square. Those sound like enormous orbs, but the harmonic chart has actually blown everything up by 11, and it's actually a little over a 1 degree orb. I don't want to try to explain that, and you don't need to understand it. Just all you have to know is that we use a 16 degree orb for conjunctions based on this harmonic theory, 8 for opposition, and 4 for squares. And I know that doesn't sound right, but this is not a normal chart. And I have videos, tutorial videos that explain it. So using the 16 degree orb, we have a Sun, Chiron, Uranus opposite the Mars-Jupiter. There's the Mars-Jupiter conjunction. All three of these people have a Mars-Jupiter conjunction. What does this indicate? It indicates action, success, restlessness, love of music, love of dance, love needing to be in that rhythm and in that flow. And what does Chiron do? Chiron, which it's multiplied by 11, now it's a 10-minute orb. It's actually a 1-minute orb in the chart. Chiron gives that ability to her Sun to be magnetic, to get that quiet charisma, to take that action and spontaneity of Uranus and bring it in there. She started off as a dancer. She got into an accident. She didn't give up. She became a singer. She became a superstar. Chiron power. Chiron can make you a superstar. Why Mars-Jupiter? Because of the energy that's required. Most of us would be exhausted one day of all the acting and all the action and all the activity. These people thrive on this fast-paced action and movement, the dance, the music, the theater, the screen. Mars-Jupiter is success. Sun, Chiron, Uranus, action, spontaneity, made modest by Chiron. We look at Waylon Jennings, very different kind of musician, but also an individual. Chiron is very good for individual performance because of the charisma that it generates. Here's Waylon Jennings, also Mars conjunct Jupiter. And with the Sun, Chiron, Pluto opposite Neptune, Mars and Jupiter nearby, the Mars and Jupiter also square the Moon, similar to Doris Day. The Sun, Chiron, Trine, Mercury. All what this indicates is a person who needs a fast-paced life, action, and has star power because of Chiron with the Sun to focus it, channel it, and make it alive and make it vibrant. With Pluto making it compulsive, Mars, Jupiter, success, the Neptune gives life and inspiration. A lot of energy and a lot of power, which is often ignored as an important part of being a superstar, but getting on stage in front of those lights and doing these performances and remembering all these chords and all these songs, and it's high power stuff, and these high power people succeed at it. Now, here's the interesting thing I found. I looked at Jeff Bridges' 11th harmonic. He also has Mars conjunct Jupiter, just like the other two, and just like Waylon Jennings, he has the Sun Chiron with Pluto. In this case, it's opposite Pluto. So they all have extremely similar charts. Mars-Jupiter, Sun Chiron, Sun Chiron-Pluto, Sun Chiron-Mars, extremely similar charts, all three of them. Okay? Now, you might say, David, you're really on a fishing expedition. You're giving me all these stupid minor aspects with all these different charts. Well, let me show you the next part of the story, and then I'll take some questions. So can the 11th harmonic be so important? Seems unlikely. I know a lot of you are doubtful, and I just wanted you to hold on for here's the clincher. All right, you ready for this? This really is shocking. It shocked me, even though I believe in this form of astrology. I went to Google, and I Googled Jeff Bridges and Waylon Jennings because I thought, oh, my God, these guys have the same 11th harmonic pattern with the sun Chiron. I know one's an actor and one's a country music singer, but I bet they must know each other. They're on the same wavelength. And why isn't Jeff Bridges singing and dancing? I couldn't figure it out. Every time I've seen him in a few movies, and you know, he's a great actor, but sometimes there's action in the movie. I could see it a little bit because he's action oriented sometimes. I was just curious, and what I found out was amazing, and I make a note here. I love when astrology knows more than I do. First thing I find out is on a website. I didn't put the website address here, but title of the article was Jeff Bridges Channels Waylon, Willie, and Chris in Crazy Heart. So Jeff Bridges was in a movie. I'm not a big entertainment person, so I don't know what it is. There's a movie called Crazy Heart where he plays an aging country music legend, and this particular reviewer thought he did such a great job that he was channeling the kind of energy of Waylon Jennings, Willie Nelson, and Kris Kristofferson. Another review I found, Bad Blake, that's the name of the character that Jeff Bridges plays in this movie, is the main character in the acclaimed new movie Crazy Heart. This was obviously written when the movie was new. Is an interesting bunch of fellows, wonderfully played and sung. Oh, my God. Stop. Time out. My heart stopped when I read this. I literally took off my glasses, scratched my head, and said, what? He sings? Sings by actor Jeff Bridges. Blake is a veteran country music singer whose character is a composite of various country stars, past and present. They include, he lists some of the same people, including Waylon Jennings. This gave me chills from head to toe because I'm thinking from the astrology these people are similar, and it gets, here's the clincher. This is what really blew my mind. I'll read this whole thing. I give the website address on somebody reviewing, talking about Jeff Bridges. If his career, talking about Jeff Bridges as an actor, which is far from over, isn't enough for a lifetime or two, Bridges also could be remembered as a singer, songwriter, musician. That caught my attention. What? He writes songs too? He's actually a real musician? And then, though he didn't release his debut, Be Here Soon until 2000, he made an album. This just blew my mind. Bridges has been writing and performing music for most of his life? Really? And he's not another actor who thinks he can rock because he's a Hollywood star. Bridges displays true aptitude as a musician. Take away the star status, and he'd still be able to sell records and fill seats at his shows. The reviewer is saying this guy is a real another Waylon Jennings. Blew my mind because the astrology works so well. So what you find is the Sun Chiron. I started off thinking Sun Chiron is this electrical energy coming into a clear form, like skating or a musical performance. If any of you are musicians, you know you just can't go flying all over the place. You got to move those chords and those sounds, and it's got to be precisely done or it's a mess. Breathing life into those forms is the special power of Chiron, the 11th harmonic, giving the vibrancy, the strength, the love of movement, the love of action. When Waylon Jennings and Chris and Jeff Bridges get up in the morning, they don't sit there thinking, gee, I think I want to curl up with a book and, you know, or solve problems all day. There's life, there's vitality, Mars, Jupiter in the 11th with the Sun, Mars, Pluto. They're alive, they're vibrant, they love it. They get out the electric guitars and they live. So that's it. So my conclusion is that Chiron is lovely and sometimes as lively and sometimes charismatic expressionist through a pattern is confirmed. 11th harmonic and musical performance, because music is a dynamic art form, is confirmed. I had no idea Jeff Bridges was a musician, an outstanding musician evidently. The patterns with Sun, Mars, Jupiter, Chiron, Uranus, and Pluto in 11th harmonic are helpful for dynamic personal performance and high energy. These are high energy people. Interesting. So even if you think vibrational astrology is nuts, you could at least sympathize with me that I have a reason for being nuts. You know, the evidence is fairly strong. So again, I'm restricting myself to these charts because the research said I have to look at them. I'm using the methods that I like to look for, and I'm getting very strong confirmation that these things work, and I'm learning a little bit more about how these patterns work. Okay, I'm introducing you to a lot of new ideas. Let me summarize. Number one, what we call in research methodology convenient sampling is not enough. Doing the charts of friends and family, I think it's extremely important. I think it's a step that should not be skipped. I think you can get better and better at it. Take in the full feeling and mood of, I have a Moon, Neptune, Pluto. I love to just go into these you know, reveries and connect on an intuitive emotional level. I think it works, it's good. But we also need to test our ideas more clearly. We don't have to jump into statistical analysis. We do exploratory research, which controls us from doing what we call convenient sampling, forces us, and as a result of doing that, we start making new breakthroughs. Okay, so what does Chiron mean? More evidence that it is life, vibrancy, being channeled through a specific circuitry. Enid, do we have questions?
One question on your methodology, you used only sun and moon. What about ascendant? Did you not find, or is because that one is so determined on time?
Yeah, that's the problem with the ascendant. I would love to use the ascendant, but the problem is, what I want is I want people that I know are extreme Chiron people. It's okay if I miss a lot of Chiron people. This is a fine distinction and it's important. If I miss 50 people who are huge Chiron people because my criteria are not good, that's okay. That doesn't bother me that much. What I'm concerned about is that the people I pick must be Mr. or Miss Chiron. They have to be the poster child, the, you know, archetypal Chiron people. That's the concept behind the research. So with the ascendant, I don't know. What if the birth time's off by 8 minutes? We have no way of knowing. I have to be 100% sure. Why do I have to be 100% sure, or as close to 100% as possible? Because I'm hinging my knowledge on this, that I must explain these Chiron people. So that's why. Now, I could have done Mercury. I could have done Venus. But I just started there. I just thought it was a good place to start. The research is endless. We can go back and look at Mercury, look at Venus, do whatever. But the amazing thing is that even though you've limited yourself and haven't found everybody, the breakthroughs you make are unbelievable. I mean, they're just unbelievable. I got a whole new insight into Waylon Jennings and how the 11th harmonic works and what it means to be a rock musician or a country western musician, et cetera. My knowledge and understanding grew immensely just from that. So it works. Okay.
The other question, though, is you commented that all three of them had that Mars-Jupiter. So how did you tease out what was Chiron and what was being the effect of that strong connection with the Mars-Jupiter?
The Sun Chiron gives the personal magnetism, the being a channel. When you have Sun Chiron that close, you can be a Reiki healer. You can be a massage therapist. You can be, if everything else allows, you can be a rock star, probably a fairly humble rock star in most cases. Now, I'm taking it out of context. You have the whole rest of the chart. But the Sun Chiron, that's strong for all three of them, is that they are all charismatic people. And Jeff Bridges is also not very flamboyant. He doesn't overact. So this is very, very common. You're able to take that vibrancy and put it into, not only can you, but you have a strong motivation to focus it, get it precise, and be a little bit perfectionist to get that right. That's where the Chiron comes in. The rest of the patterns just explain the Mars, Jupiter, and everything. It just shows their emphasis on 11th harmonic lifestyle for those three people. And they all lived a demanding 11th harmonic lifestyle.
When you do your 11th harmonic, I mean, you're using dividing the chart up. Do you also use any of those concepts in just degree? Like I know some people will say, okay, if you're a planet at any sign at 22 degrees, you're getting a particular vibration. Or do you not have that as part of your research?
I don't use that, but you know, it very well could work. I think that all of us probably only understand 1 or 2% of astrology. I mean, there's so many millions of ideas and so on. But one of the things that I've been focused on is I want to get something that works consistently, that will predict to me, you know, what happens. So I only use a very small subset of astrological ideas that work.
Okay.
And it grows rapidly. This whole system that I use is very intricate, very sophisticated, and it's grown actually over 40 years. I started in 1972. But there's still millions of things I don't use that probably work, but I don't know how to use them. And that would be
okay.
One of them.
So you've been working with the longitude aspects. What about declination? Have you explored that at all?
I have, but I haven't been able to get consistent results yet. There are probably 100 things that work for every one thing that I am confident that works. But like all astrologers, some astrologers rely, you know, on a few basic aspects using modern, some, you know, use Hellenistic time lords, etc. So, you know, like every astrologer, I have the subset that I use, and that's what I'm showing, and how I combine that, use that in this Chiron research to determine how Chiron works.
The last one here, this has all been on natal. Have you done anything working with the transit?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, I have three addendum slides. It shows when John F. Kennedy, former President Kennedy, gave a speech, "We will go to the moon." It's very dynamic. That speech actually had a huge effect on me. And when you watch the transits at that time, including Chiron, to his chart is a seventh harmonic involving Chiron, and then you watch how his chart and the transits affected my chart, it's mind-boggling. Also, I have a tutorial video on this evil guy, Roger. The guy just shot up a bunch of people in California and shot himself. I show how you use transits with that. I have a bunch of tutorial videos that explain. But yes, I use it with transits and very much. All right. Now, so I've talked about three people, Waylon Jennings, Jeff Bridges, and Doris Day. I had four or five other people up there. Let's look at them. This next person, Arissa Hill, she's also going to have the 11th harmonic and 5th harmonic of being creative and playful. And we will see how Chiron works into this. I don't know why I've got 5 in yellow and 11 was probably supposed to be in yellow too. But anyway, 11, again, is restless. It's in motion. It's progressive. It's hungry. It's hungry to get somewhere. And of the different art forms, it's most attracted to music because music is moving. Here's an interview with Arissa Hill. Let me show you her chart first, and then I'll show you the interview. I'm not even going to show you her natal chart just because I don't have a lot of time. But here's her 5th harmonic chart. When you see a bunch of planets lined up like this all together, it means you have extremely strong 5th harmonic. So within 16-degree orb, she has Moon, Saturn, Uranus, and Mercury opposite Jupiter. And what this tells me is, first of all, she's a 5th harmonic person. She should be playing and creating. Saturn and Uranus is out of the box. Moon, Mercury shows up in actors very often because they have to memorize all these lines and play emotions and communicate the emotions and time period. Things are set in a certain setting and the mood. Moon, Mercury, so opposite Jupiter, lending enthusiasm, largeness. She has a good sense of structure and design with Jupiter, Saturn. So she's an out-of-the-box designer, developer, possibly actress, creative person. Chiron's not involved in this pattern. It shows up in the 11th harmonic. So basically, you look at these vibrations and see what vibration you're on by which patterns have the strongest. She has very strong 5, and she has very strong 11. And here's her 11th harmonic, and here the Sun Chiron is involved. She has a Sun Chiron, Jupiter, Neptune, and 11th harmonic. It doesn't matter that much whether they're conjunct, opposition, or square. They're 11-based. What does it mean to have Sun Chiron, Jupiter, Neptune in an 11 vibration? Think about it. Jupiter and Neptune are what? Big, right? Wanderlust, you know, expansive, next horizon, go to an exotic place. So she's a Sun, Jupiter, Neptune, restless. She probably travels a lot, exotic, glamorous. And with Chiron is giving her the ability to have that charisma to channel it, to be a focal point for this glamour. So basically I see her as a glamour or exotic, restless person who can't sit still, and a wild maniac creative person. That would be my interpretation. You're starting to get the idea? This is where the Chiron comes into it. So what I'm doing is I'm taking the general findings and seeing where that Sun Chiron vibration, the Sun Chiron picks up a strong vibration. I analyzed the charts, came up with my idea of what I would see, and then I Googled around to try to find information. I found, for example, this interview. Okay, interviewer says, introduce yourself. Arissa says, my name is Arissa Hill. I am a model, entertainer, and television personality, best known for starring on the 12th season of MTV's reality show, The Real World. I think it probably should be called The Unreal World, which was filmed in Las Vegas, right? Las Vegas, Jupiter, Neptune, restless. I had no idea who, I never heard of her. But I looked at the charts. I said, this is how her Sun Chiron is operating. Sure enough, she's in that glamorous lifestyle, MTV, Las Vegas. I researched her more. She grew up in New Jersey. It's not like she grew up and her parents were in that industry and she just was born into it. What are some of your interests? Now, by the way, I didn't cut anything out of this part of the interview. This is the interview goes on and on, but this is the full part of her answer. My interests have to do with anything creative, kabong, painting, photography, music, cooking, writing. Okay, this fits. I submerge myself in all things that have to do with creation. I'm glad she understands herself. All things that have to do with creation. She's on the five vibration. She's charismatic. She became a star on TV with the Sun Chiron. She's restless. She's all over the place. Next question, what's the thought process behind your works? I allow my world and everything in it to be a source of inspiration. This is Miss Sun, Chiron, Jupiter, Neptune, 11th harmonic. Everything, yep, Jupiter, Neptune, everything. I draw from personal experience, and I believe that feeds the creativity that lives in me. So the basic idea that I'm suggesting is that astrology really works not only for psychological processes, you can actually tell what people do. You can use it for vocational counseling. You can see what vibration they're on. You can see what makes them, what ticks for them. And she fits. I think she fits very well. So the whole point of this was, does the Sun Chiron make sense in context? I think it does. She's not a healer. I don't know about how much wounding she had, but you see that electricity coming through her to make her a celebrity, celebrity power, MTV, etc. So that's Arissa Hill, the huge fifth harmonic pattern, but it didn't include Sun Chiron, but it made sense. And the Sun, Chiron, Jupiter, Neptune, T-square, similar to Christian Dior, who's also in the with fashion and glamour. Christian Dior has an incredible, huge pattern in the 11th harmonic. I'll show that to you quickly. He was the one who had at the bottom of the list, Christian Dior. Look at this huge grand cross, Sun, Jupiter. He has a Sun, Jupiter, Neptune, just like Arissa Hill. They'll probably team up at some point if they haven't already. When was he born? He's out of it. 1905, sorry. They can't team up. Maybe in her dreams. But otherwise, they probably would because they both have Sun, Jupiter, Neptune. Anyway, the glamour industry is very appropriate for this on-the-go, active. The Sun Chiron that he has giving him that charisma. I know his name, and I don't know any of these people. If I know his name, he must have something going on. That's how strong his presence is. Okay, so conclusions, it works. She's in a flashy, somewhat glamorous lifestyle. She has big dreams, etc. What do I predict for her? I predict she will sometimes reach too high and fail because of the Jupiter Neptune. She'll continue to impress others. She will stay in the limelight. She will do a lot of different things, sometimes surprise others because of that Saturn Uranus with her unusual creativity. But she has star power, and she's not going away because of Chiron involved with it. Okay, you getting the idea? I'm going to show you a few more of these to show how we see the vibrations and how the Chiron works and describes what the people do, what their special talent is, and what they're skilled in. Now, harmonics 7 and 77 show up in the next person, which is discipline, focus, and introversion. A classic example, and I have a tutorial video on her, is the female tennis player who married Andre Agassi, Steffi Graf. Yeah, Steffi Graf is interesting. She's a triple Gemini, Sun, Moon, Ascendant, and Gemini. Well, let me just pull up her chart, getting a little off subject, not off subject, but Steffi Graf. Just pull up her chart real quickly. Select, now look at her, she's triple Gemini. Sun, Moon, Ascendant, and the ruler of Gemini is in Gemini. She was very quiet. She didn't like to talk a lot. She doesn't talk quickly like I do. she's not hyperactive. She's, you know, if you don't use whole sign houses, you could say it's the 12th house, but then you'd have to stick to 12th house, really clamping down on energy a lot. She was just the opposite of Gemini in terms of being quiet and not a chatterbox at all. And if we look at her seventh harmonic chart, I expected her to have a strong seven because she was famous for her incredible discipline and perseverance. Just practice, practice, practice. She was not the greatest star as a child, but through practice. And everything's at 6 or 7 degrees, all making trines and sextiles and squares to each other. Pluto's at 7 degrees. Moon and Jupiter at 7 degrees. Neptune is at 6.5 degrees. Mars is at 7 degrees. Mars trine Moon Jupiter. Saturn trine Pluto for her asceticism. Neptune actually is good in these patterns, by the way. I didn't expect it, but it adds magic to these things. It doesn't make it weak. Strong seventh harmonic patterns, which is what we expect. So back to my presentation. My point is that you can actually, what I'm suggesting is that you actually see that people have extraordinary power. Two of the greatest baseball players of all time, I have a tutorial video on this, Hank Aaron and Ty Cobb, both have these seven type patterns of almost extremely similar. You'll see it over and over and over again. So this is what shows up. Tyrone Hill, he's a basketball player. And what we find out is that in the 11th harmonic, for speed, he has Sun, Chiron, Mars, Neptune, Pluto. Neptune, again, is not bad in these things. He's got the Mars, Pluto, the power. The Sun, Chiron is very good for athletes because of their focus on the behavior that they need to do. And the 77, which often shows up in the huge people. And he has the Saturn and Uranus. That is extremely powerful. When you get Saturn and Uranus with Chiron and the Sun, and it's very similar to some things you see in Muhammad Ali. Let me show you Tyrone Hill, who's one of the best basketball players. Here's his 11th harmonic, the Sun Chiron. Chiron gives you this extra boost to be a channel, to breathe life into the pattern. When he's playing basketball, he's not thinking to himself, oh, I need to block this guy, I need to throw this pass. He's in the zone. It's that Uranian power into the pattern. He's got the Sun Chiron with Mars and Pluto. All very, very tight. See how fat the lines are? It means the aspects are exact. So Mars, Pluto with the Sun and Chiron, you have one powerhouse. They call him a power forward. You would want some seventh harmonic or something to give discipline to this. Otherwise, he could just be in fights all the time. This could be a guy who's in street fights or something. But he has the 77th harmonic where all together within 16 degrees, he's got the Sun with Saturn and Uranus, the two planets related to Chiron, and the Sun Uranus squares the Moon Mars. For the competition, he's got Mars square Uranus, the power, the competition. 77 is a harmonic that shows up in extraordinary athletes because they have the speed with control. And Chiron gives the extra boost to be a channel, basically, to be in that zone. And it shows up a lot in people with exceptional talent, as it shows up here. These people are not normal. These are extraordinary athletes, among the best. Okay, so there it is. the son Chiron, again, he's not a wounded healer, he's not a healer, he's a basketball player. What does Chiron have to do with basketball? It seems like not much. It seems like a mundane thing. But given the interpretation I'm giving half for these, this is very powerful. Sun, Saturn, and Uranus with Chiron means you can move and shake things and respond very, very quickly. And basketball requires these fast reflexes and being clear about where you are and where everybody else is and be able to make quick decisions and adjust very rapidly, which he excels at. Again, it's power, Mars, Uranus. Okay, so the research is telling me that if I think Chiron is wounded healer, it does not match all of my people. Remember my original concept? According to this research design, it has to fit all of the people. Otherwise, my interpretation is probably wrong. But if I look at it as this channeling of Uranian spontaneity in a zone that makes for great athletes and performers, almost all the people fit that description, and the Sun Chiron ties up with the kinds of patterns we expect using vibrational astrology. I always look to 77. Believe it or not, you might think this guy's really, David's really lost it. The 77th harmonic, what's wrong with you? What's your problem, David? No problem. It's just I have a different language of astrology, that this vibration being on this wavelength gives that ability. Just for fun, I pulled up Muhammad Ali just to give you another example. There's Muhammad Ali with 11-degree orbs. He's got Saturn, Mercury, Mars, and Uranus. There's the Mars-Uranus again, very common in the 77th harmonic with power people, such as a sudden release of energy. You even see it in skaters because when they do that big jump, the figure skaters, they get ready and then they have to explode and do that triple twirl or whatever they call it, that explosion of energy. You'll see it in baseball players where the swing of the bat is a sudden explosion. Control with speed. You'll see it obviously in boxing, control and speed. And his Chiron, Chiron gives you the extra boost to have that power, to be a channel in the moment. So you have Mars, Uranus, Sun, Chiron, very similar to Tyrone Hill. Now, Muhammad Ali is not part of my research study. I'm just showing this for illustrative purposes, not for demonstrating the idea's work. I'm cherry-picking for the purpose of illustration, which is different from forcing myself with a research methodology to find out something. And notice with Muhammad Ali, his Venus is exactly conjunct the Sun in the pattern that makes him one of the greatest boxers of all time. He had this thing he used to say, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. If you have Mars, Uranus, Sun, Chiron, throw in Mercury for fast nervous system, you sting like a bee. And, of course, this is why he's so pretty, right? Muhammad Ali, his main pattern that makes him a superstar boxer happens to have Venus, which is totally irrelevant. Basically, except it adds a little more energy to it, but it makes him pretty. It's amazing how people express exactly what's going on, because normally you don't have Venus involved. He happens to have it there, and that's why he's prettier than everybody else, according to him. He actually was a good-looking guy. But he weaves that into this whole thing. And the moon often gets involved, which you see again, moon square Uranus. We see that over and over again in these power type people. Okay, so the point being this, we're trying to see if what Chiron is. Is it wounded healer? Is it quiet charisma? Or is it what I say, an electric circuit, electricity going through a definitive, clearly defined circuit? And I'm finding the specific things in the charts. Now, most of you can do the research and see if the artists have whatever you think they have, and the athletes have whatever you think they have, squares or trines to Mars and so on, and you might find something else. I'm just showing you another style of doing it. The bottom line of all this is that it's verifying what Chiron does, and with the model that I use for astrology, it's also helping refine the understanding and demonstrating how that works. Okay, I'm going to show you a few more examples.
David,
yep.
Do you have a question on you know, most people are used to the idea of a study having lots and lots and lots of people in it. But what you're saying is that when you pull from thousands of charts and you get the ones who show the most intense focus, am I paraphrasing your methodology?
You have nailed it. That's exactly yeah. right. You have nailed it, and I'm glad you said that, because we often think of research as either you're doing, you know, your charts of your friends and family and so on, or you're going to collect thousands of charts and do a statistical study and, quote, prove astrology. We sometimes have this sort of dichotomy where you're either doing your normal astrology stuff, or you would have to do some big fancy thing with all these statistics. Actually, that's not the way research is normally done in the social sciences. There's a huge amount of stuff in between what we call a hypothesis test, where you collect a bunch of data and see if your idea works, and what we call convenient sampling, which is what we normally do. And it's extremely difficult to jump from convenient sampling to a hypothesis test. And also, some of the exploratory research methods, like extreme case sampling, which is the method I'm using, are very easy to do. And they don't require all the things that we think are required in research, but at least according to research methodologists and academics in the social sciences, are tremendously better than anecdotal evidence. So you're making a big step forward in verifying what works and what doesn't work, and also learning new ideas by simply taking the top 4, 5, or 6 people, or top 10, wherever you want to make your cutoff point, that fits your criterion. It's much easier. You don't have to look at thousands of charts. You don't have to run statistics. But you're, according to academic 21st century, 20th and 21st century thinking, you're doing something that's serious, that's respectable from the modern epistemological point of view. Now, you may or may not agree with that point of view, but I happen to agree with it, along with being a loony, you know, vegetarian guy who crosses his legs at 4 o'clock in the morning and stares at his third eye. I also like this other stuff because I think it helps. It helps me sort out what really works.
And so, like you said, when you get the top 10, you can't leave any of them out.
That's, you got it. Boy, Enid, you should teach this class. You do better than me. That's the point. You have to follow the rules. You can't leave one of them out. You can't. Now, if they don't all fit, you know, it's not the end of the world, but it's sort of depressing. This kind of research can definitely make you manic depressive, because sometimes things just don't quite all fit together. I've been working on this literally for 40 years. I haven't talked about it a lot at conferences. It's for the most part been my own little hidden world. People know I do harmonics, but they have no idea that. And it does get kind of manic. But over the decades, it's gotten more and more refined and works more and more consistently, with fewer and fewer depressing days where half the charts just don't work. But yes, you're absolutely right about all those are very, very important points. Okay. All right, I'm going to summarize these very quickly. The 35th is discipline and creativity, often expressed as fine art. Who do we expect to have that? Michelle Kwan, and she has huge 35th harmonic. She also has 77th harmonic. I don't really have time to show you all this. Maybe I'll just summarize it without showing you these charts, because I'd like to show you this last thing at the end. But anyway, she has exactly what we expect with the Chiron involved. The theory works if we consider 35th, 11th, and 77th harmonics to be important. Those are the ones that came up very strong. She's one of the greatest creators of all time, and the strong patterns give her the ability to excel. George Brock, he was one of the ones that is not as obvious of a Chiron person. As I mentioned before, he developed cubism with Picasso. He's often credited, even more than Picasso, with creating the idea, the style of painting. He says, quote, I think I quote from Wikipedia, objects shattered into fragments as a way of getting closest to the object. Fragmentation helped me to establish space and movement in space. It's abstract painting, and the 29th harmonic is very abstract, and he has an incredibly powerful 29th harmonic pattern. I can't resist showing it to you, which I think relates to his abstract interests and 29th harmonic. Look at that. Oh, man, it's got Sun, Saturn, Uranus. His whole chart's lined up in this. So he's obsessed with his vision and sense of getting movement out of forms and so on. I'm running out of time, but the 29th harmonic, I give some meanings of it here. I actually have a complete online book that's free, which is here, where I talk about these things, and you can go to this website and actually read an entire book on the meanings of these harmonics. It's free and it's up there. And then there's Shirley Babishov. She was the only one who I didn't predict which harmonic was involved. And the reason is because I didn't have in mind ahead of time 33 and 99. And it ends up it's in the 33rd and 99 harmonic. And I didn't have that idea ahead of time. So in the future, when I look at swimmers in particular, which is a graceful sport, it's not a staccato, like a sudden, abrupt response type thing, you're going to get these smooth 11th harmonic patterns. Interestingly, she has a strong 99th harmonic, and she was involved in a controversy of the competition the East Germans were using performance-enhancing drugs. She didn't like it. I don't really have time to talk about all this, but it fits. Nine is about community. Ninth harmonic people believe it's not who wins or loses, it's how you play the game. These Germans were cheating, and not only were they cheating, a lot of the women decades later had severe health problems as a result of the heavy drugging, etc., and now she's often considered to be a hero as one of the people who stood up against drugging. So I learned something there to keep my eyes open for 33rd and 99th harmonic, and that's how I make discoveries. Usually in a research project, most things will work. A few things will be a little bit new, such as when I discovered 11th harmonic with music when I studied the Gaukelin data. So in summary, we have learned some new ways to find out what works in astrology. The extreme case sampling, we've learned that there are weird and crazy people like David who think that these vibrations are incredibly important. So whether you're interested in learning more about that or not, at least you know how far some people have taken it. Another language in astrology. Here I list some other resources. The series seminar is coming up on July 12th. I have over 90 free tutorial videos at YouTube. There's a section on harmonic vibrational symmetrical astrology. There's, of course, our software companies have written two books. There is a DVD where I describe the harmonic, or what I now call vibrational astrology system. And here's the last thing I want to do. This is a more emotional sort of thing. John Kennedy gave a speech about we're going to go to the moon. I was always an intellectual kid, and I was always studying philosophy and science and all this crazy stuff, even when I was very young. When I watched the news and I heard John Kennedy speak, it actually changed the direction of my life, because I felt like he was right, and I'm going to do what he said. And basically in this speech, he says, we're going to go to the moon, not because it is easy, but because it is hard, as he would say in his Massachusetts accent. And I thought to myself, this is what I want to do. I want to devote myself to something that's important and work hard at it, unlike the other people I grew up with on Long Island who just want to make a lot of money and live on Easy Street. This whole idea really grabbed me. And basically what happens, I'll show you this very quickly because we are over time. If we look at the time of the speech and we look at a bi-wheel, this is John Kennedy's seventh harmonic, and the outer ring of the seventh harmonic. This is John Kennedy in the middle. He has a Sun, Saturn, Uranus in the seventh harmonic. Seventh harmonic is discipline, training. Saturn, Uranus means making trainings. Saturn, Uranus is making changes, radical changes. He wants to make radical changes through commitment, through dedication. He talks about how we're going to send a man to the moon within 10 years by the end of the decade. The man went to the moon in 1969. He gave the speech in 1962. At the time he gives the speech, Saturn and Uranus, these are transiting Saturn and Uranus at the time of the speech, are trying his Saturn Uranus. The change that is happening right there. The transiting sun is on his sun Saturn Uranus. There's a sun trying Saturn Uranus, hitting his sun Saturn Uranus when he makes this very moving speech. The speech has a huge effect on me. I decide John Kennedy is right. I want to do what he's talking about. I want to devote myself to making a real meaningful change. I want to do it not because it is easy, but because it is hard. Here's my chart. I'm getting a little choked up here. I get very emotional about my abstract ideas. The true nerd to the core. Here's my natal sun, which is exactly trine the natal moon in the seventh harmonic, indicating a person who wants to dedicate himself to something is introverted and nerdy. I'm basically a hermit until you let me out in public, and then I act like a madman. And then what happens here is that transiting sun on Kennedy's Saturn Uranus is exactly opposite my sun. All the Chirons are at the same degree. Transiting Chirons at 25 degrees, square my Chiron at 24 degrees. Here's Kennedy with his Mercury Chiron, his ability to speak. Chiron is a channel. His speaking moved me. He shook me up with his Mercury Chiron, and basically I spent the rest of my life trying to do something that was not easy, but because it is hard. That has stuck with me ever since then. And here's a link to the video. 50 years ago, Saturn returns to where it is every 51 years. About 2 years after he gave the speech is where Saturn is now. So as people were working on this moon program, we are now at the Saturn, the Chiron return of that. So anyway, that I just wanted to share that. Shows you how you can use transits, how you can relate these things, how it's meaningful, how it relates to very big highlights, and how you can look at its relevance in your chart. Amen. God bless. Namaste. I think the wind-up toy has finally reached the end.
That was lovely. How will they find you?
You can email me. It's davidc@astrosoftware.com.
And the software that he was using, if you hadn't figured it out already, was the Sirius program that you are the prime architect for.
Yep.
And it is a fabulous astrological program. The only other question I think was on these different harmonic charts. Do you use different orbs on each of them based on how they're dividing the circle?
I use the same orbs on every harmonic chart. And let me just show you this very quickly. If you go to YouTube, and then you search at the top, just search for my name, for example, or David Cochrane Astrologer. And then on any of these videos that says by my name, click on my name, and it takes you to the page. And this is what I was talking about. There are videos here, Introduction to Harmonic Astrology. So there's whole sections on harmonics and vibrational astrology, on relocational astrology, also things that that have nothing to do with my specialization, Introduction to Vedic Astrology. Basically, I try to make at least one video a week, sometimes two. I'm planning to have an entire free educational system here on every area of astrology, and it's totally free. I got inspired by Khan Academy. Anyway, there is a video here on the first one, Introduction to Harmonic Astrology. And these are about a half hour long, and there's over 90 of them, so you can get lost here for a long time. And the link to the free book, one way to get there is you go to astrosoftware.com. If you go to information@astrosoftware.com, and then articles on the left, and then you'll see all the articles. And I've also written dozens of articles, and one of these is the free book. Here it is. It's a large PDF file on the meanings of the first 32 harmonics and the research I did. Also has at the beginning of it a summary of what other astrologers said about harmonics. So it's a good resource for knowing what did John Addy say, what does David Hamblin say, what do other experts in harmonic astrology say about the meanings of harmonics. Anyway, it's...
Well, thank you.
Well, thank you so much. Thanks, everyone, for coming. I really appreciate you all taking some time out on your Saturday to be here.